the way to look at it is not about digital financial services replacing cash completely. It is more about enabling people to use digital financial services where very clearly they themselves perceive that cash is more inconvenient. Well, I think that is the starting point. So I think with that in mind, I think people do recognize that in certain contexts, it is more challenging to use cash. Like, for example, if you have to queue up in a line for a long time to make a bill payment, or you have to queue up for a long time to receive a benefit transfer from the government, or you have to wait for a few days to be able to receive the payments from friends and relatives, right? So these are contexts where very clearly people prefer would prefer digital financial services based on the pure kind of the higher, better qualities of digital financial services. The challenges which will need to be addressed is, first of all, I think there's a, we should not underestimate the lack of familiarity of the people who have not used digital financial services, and in particular the poor. They might have certain very specific context for them related to their particular circumstances, which makes it difficult for them to relate to digital financial services. They might not know how to use it. So I think the single biggest thing which will have to be done is to make it more comfortable for them to use it. And this could be done in the context of perhaps providing them a safe environment for them to first try and use it in their own community with the help of community members. And then they'll become more familiar. So that would be my quick response on that. I think they will reshape in a very, very fundamental way. I think artificial intelligence perhaps is already starting to have an impact, and in blockchain perhaps it'll take some more time for its effects to be fully felt. Let me take a few examples to illustrate that point. If you take the case of artificial intelligence, I think starting from things like customer service, where an individual is contacting a financial service institution, typically it is either done by coming in person to the branch or trying to talk on phone with a live agent. All of this adds to the cost of the financial institution. It's also inconvenient to the consumer. But things like using natural language processing, which is of course one of the fields of AI, things like chatbots are becoming almost similar in experience to what you would have done in a live conversation with an agent. So I think that is one area. Then the other area, which is also where AI is already being applied, is in terms of being able to validate an identity of a person remotely, where there are some gaps in the national government's digital IDs, digital capabilities. I think there are solutions which are coming in now where you can actually validate the liveness of an individual, and then also compare the photo of a person as presented in a video conversation with what is there in the national ID, so that way trying to mimic and simulate what you would have done in a physical visit to a branch where you would have validated the photo ID versus the person who's appearing in front of you. So I think that's another example where, again, very clearly AI techniques are used for that. Then the third area is about fraud detection, where patterns of usage, when anything out of normal, is where AI can help in detecting. And I think increasingly, this is an area as more digital financial services start getting used. I think this is an area which will need a lot of attention, and AI will certainly help. And then the last area I would like to highlight is about what things related to alternative data and how AI can be used to glean information from that, which will be relevant for financial institutions as part of the credit decisioning process. So I think on the AI side, I think there's already quite clearly a lot of impact which is being seen. In the case of blockchain, I think a lot of people associate blockchain also with things like cryptocurrencies and so on. So I would not spend any time on that in this conversation, because I think that's a very, very fast evolving space, and there's a lot of discussions happening, and it's still not clear in terms of where it will land. But in terms of the underlying technology of blockchain, where there are some clear applications which are emerging, particularly with respect to financial inclusion. And here, I think one example could be agricultural markets, which are typically disorganized and unorganized in many countries where we work, the World Bank as an institution works, to bring in more transparency to the whole value chain of agriculture, that way unlocking better pricing for the end farmers, better, more efficiency in the whole whole value chain, and then also kind of giving more visibility to the underlying transactions, and that way enabling financial institutions to extend more credit with a much more informed credit decisioning process to farmers. I think that could be an area where blockchain is perhaps already having some effect, and people are already experimenting with that. I think in some sense, digital financial services seem to have been custom built for the kind of context in which all of us find ourselves in. So digital financial services in some sense is enabling us to carry on at least with some semblance of normality, our day-to-day kind of commercial interactions, and then also allowing businesses to somehow continue to function, right? So in that sense, I think the digital financial services is a very clear enabler for the COVID response, and the COVID response has also raised the awareness about the potential of digital financial services amongst people who had access but were never using it before because of habit. So in that sense, it has forced them to step out of their comfort zone with the way they were already transacting and interacting with financial services to now explore digital financial services. And then for people who did not have, I think the urgency of getting access to it became even more because of the COVID crisis. And then in the case of regulators, in many cases there was some degree of hesitation in implementing some reforms. There were some long drawn discussions in some countries. All of that got really hastened because of the crisis. So a lot of the decision making on those things actually really moved very fast now, and many countries actually made changes which were barriers to digital financial services because of the COVID crisis, to make it more easier for people to transact digitally and have some degree of semblance of normality and get more convenience. No? So I think the COVID crisis has in a sense created a more enabling environment for digital financial services in some sense, or provided an impetus rather. And at the same time, the digital financial services has also helped in coping with the COVID crisis. This symposium, of course, is going to be held in a different format. So I think there's a lot of anticipation to see how this will play out. And hopefully this will give more time for people to engage, given that people can watch it at their own, can have access to this information for a longer period of time. So hopefully this will make it more accessible to more people. And then also, I think this is being held at a time when quite a bit is happening in this field, right? So, and hopefully this will provide an opportunity to exchange views and perspectives and hear different experiences. And then the third point I would like to highlight is, in some sense, this is also the last symposium in the Fiji series, in the current Fiji series. So I think it's also an opportunity to look back and see how the Fiji program has performed, what have we learned, and what progress have we achieved. So I think because of all these reasons, I think this symposium is likely to be much awaited and then also much appreciated by everybody. Thank you.